You can now hear Movie Heaven, Movie Hell on Stitcher. Stitcher is radio on demand. Listen anytime, anywhere. Stitcher is an award-winning free app that lets you listen to all your favorite shows, plus discover from 20,000 news, entertainment, and sports shows. You can also create your own custom playlists. Stitcher is available on iOS, Android, Nook, iPad, and in over 4 million car dashboards. It's on demand and it's on the go. No downloading, no syncing, no wasted memory. You can stream your favorite podcasts from Stitcher. Don't have Stitcher? Download it free today at Stitcher.com or in the App Store. And please, leave us a review and rating on Stitcher. Thank you. Welcome to Movie Heaven, Movie Hell with me, Simon Aitken, and...
And I'm Keith Eyles, and we are both independent filmmakers that like to discuss films of other directors, both past and present. And currently we're going through the A to Z of directors, and we're discussing films of theirs that we like and films of theirs that maybe we don't like as much.
Exactly. Or sometimes hate.
Yeah, sometimes hate. So more rare in my case. Sometimes we hate them, yes.
Well, before we get on to tonight's director, we are recording on the 11th of January. And of course, there is one news story that is, you know, it's just out there. It's just, done corporates and sort of news events, when a big news story comes along, it usually does wipe out everybody else. And and of course this is the day that David Bowie died.
Yes, a very sad day, very sad. But you're right, it is all over the news everywhere you turn. And yeah, it's just sad that the entertainment industry is always losing good people. Mr. Bowie was certainly one of them. So yes, very sad, very, very, bringing us back to January after Christmas joy, etc. So, maybe we'll, at some point, I don't know, maybe we'll, he did some films as well. So he might get mentioned somewhere down the track.
I'm certainly he'll appear in. Some of the films we're going to talk about. I mean, we already spoke about his role in
The Prestige. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. No, I mean, you know, he was a multi-talented individual, you know, as well as kind of an icon in many respects, you know, a fashion and style icon, you know, and a great, you know, musician and artist to boot. So, yeah, very, very sad news today for that. Absolutely.
Well, for me, a fond memory of mine from Blood and Roses was Ben Green's impression of Bowie. He always kept asking people if he was a funky, funky vampire. and of course, Blood and Roses had some influences from The Hunger.
Of course.
I mean, yes. Especially from the point of view that we never called them vampires, even though that's what they were.
Yep. Yep. So everything, it's all connected, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. One piece of work inspires another. And
indeed.
So forth.
Indeed. So yes, our first podcast of 2016, having done our Christmas and New Year specials. I do want to, by the time this podcast airs, most of the DVDs would have been sent to our winners from the selections at the new year. And but I do owe one an apology, actually. I want to say, we'll give him a mention. Andy Lunn. Yes, Andy Lunn. I said, He picked a De Palma film, which I talked about, and I said, "Yeah, don't know who Andy is or why he picked this film necessarily." And he has since reminded us via email that I did in fact sit next to Andy at this year's Fright Fest, last year's Fright Fest, and had many film discussions with him, including talking about De Palma and whatever. So my apologies that I hadn't put two and two together there and realized it was the same guy. Well, there you go. So you get a special mention on our New Year podcast.
So moving on to our director that we're going to talk about. Tonight we're going to talk about Alan Parker.
Yes, absolutely. There were a number of P's, another one of those letters where we had a few choices. But Alan Parker, you know, one of our great British film directors, born in 1944. So somebody that's, you know, always been around whilst we've been growing up and been fans and interested in movies and studying movies. I guess kind of came from a similar sort of background to Ridley Scott, would have been one of his contemporaries, I would say, because he also came out of the directing commercials and advertising background.
That's right. You should check out Alan Parker's website, alanparker.com, because not only is there like trailers and making ofs, there's also written essays about his films, and there is a reel of a lot of his old commercials, which include a lot of adverts for Benson Hedges and Bird's Eye. And there's stuff I do remember seeing some of this as a kid,
mm-hmm.
being on TV. It's got that very old stuffy English voiceover to it.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I mean, you know, he's, I always felt, you know, an interesting director, because he's quite an outspoken individual, you know, tells it as it is. But, you know, he has done an absolutely amazing, impressive body of work over the years. I mean, he's done, 28 films in 14 years, something like that, a film every 2 years or so.
Something like that, but... looking at his IMDb page, they've got him down for 19 credits as director.
Right. Okay. Yeah. So, you know, it's always, I remember seeing a lot of his films growing up, but certainly when I became, which obviously was pretty young for me anyway, when I became interested in filmmaking itself, did actually look and study, quite a few of his films, and you know he's another one that's done a, you know, quite a wide variation of different types of films, different genres. He's obviously dealt with musicals, you know so there's quite a lot there, but he always kind of admits that his influence, that though he's obviously very British, his influence has always been from American cinema.
That's right.
Very much of the sort of 30s, 40s and 50s, a bit like, I guess, you know, with our generation, it was always the 60s, 70s and 80s. But you know, he was very influenced by that, and didn't really have a sort of foot in the theatre world, or necessarily the British, or what he always sort of classed as a typical British movie. He when interviewed, always talked about his interest and in this had always come from the American side of filmmaking.
This is right. I remember seeing an interview with him on the set of Angel Heart, where he was talking about how he liked working with American actors because they weren't so trained, in his words, that they weren't theatre
right.
trained.
Yeah.
So they come across more real on screen than, say, you know, somebody from that kind of training back in that day.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, I don't know. I've never been to, you know, acting school. And I don't know if the British system is you know, more aimed at the theatre. I imagine it's not the case anymore, but back in the 70s, I'm sure that was the case.
Yeah,
I'm sure that
yeah.
a lot of the actors, their main goal was more to do theatre than it was to do TV and film.
Yeah, yeah. No, I mean, I think you're absolutely right. Over more recent years, that's probably changed a bit. But yeah, often the focus on acting is very much around theatre, and they don't necessarily do a lot of teaching about screen acting and how to act for camera, which, you know, is a, as we've talked about, I think, on previous podcasts or extras, it is a different skill set. It is a slightly different skill set. You know, it's a different tool in the toolbox. But yeah, no, I saw that interview as well. And yeah, he's, you know, very, very interesting. In 2013, he actually got his BAFTA Academy Fellowship Award. And I was lucky enough to go along to that and hear him discuss his career. And, you know, he is a very interesting fellow, but he's, you know, he has some very strong opinions, and he, you know, he's not afraid to share them.
I'm just wondering why he stopped directing films after 2003. Because, you know, yes. it's been, you know, 13 years now since his last film. And it just seems kind of weird that he kind of stopped, because, as you say, his output was very prolific. You know, it was like every year or every couple of years there was a film.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And you know, many of them gaining, you know, critical acclaim as well. So, it is interesting why he's not doing that now. I don't really know the answer to that, but I know one of the things he was kind of, and again he mentions this, he's in commentaries etc. that he does. He tends to sort of really speak his mind about this stuff. Is he's slightly frustrated with the, although he loves American movies, he's slightly frustrated with the, if you like, the studio, means of funding and getting films made, and you know, sort of copying what was a hit the previous year and churning out, you know, more of the same stuff. He said he was always interested in finding different projects that maybe people hadn't seen before, that was a bit different, and you know, and that was the sort of thing that interested him. So I know he said he sometimes struggled to find good material to go out there and make. But yeah, I in terms of why he hasn't done anything for the last 13 years, that's, I'm not too sure. And it doesn't look like he's working on anything either, does it?
No, so. No, there's nothing on IMDb, but you know, when has IMDb been right?
Well, indeed.
One of the things I like about Alan Parker is that his filmography is very eclectic. I mean, from the fact that his first, proper feature film was Bugsy Malone, which was a gangster musical with kids.
Mm. And then absolutely.
His next theatrical film was Midnight Express.
Yes.
Which was like complete polar opposite of that.
Yeah. No, absolutely. A very, very wide range of genres and types of film he's got there. But having said that, he is definitely not a direct by numbers kind of filmmaker. Having said that, his films, they often do have a certain style to them. But it's not a style that he, unlike when we were talking about De Palma, and we say you can always sort of tell a De Palma film, because he keeps using a lot of, his traits, his tools, he keeps repeating.
Yeah.
Alan Parker's slightly different in so much as he does do something quite different with them. As well as the subject matter being different, often the way he'll shoot something could be slightly different between film and film. You know, he does try new things and experiments. Although he does say that he always, and he's very good at crediting his crew, because he does tend to work with the same people right back from his commercial days. So the cinematographer and camera department, he usually takes from film to film, as he does his editor, his production designer, and so forth. So, you know, he said he often, you know, filmmaking being a team effort, you know, he surrounds himself with that team every time, you know, to go and accomplish these results.
Well, I would say the one attribute you can always tell that it's an Alan Parkin film is that it's always visually stunning, and it's always, he's a visual stylist. There's always, yeah, I mean, we'll go into it in more detail when we talk about our picks, but there's always certain sort of motifs he kinds of use, and they're always sort of serving the story. They're not there just to have a pretty shot in there. They are there for an absolute reason.
No, absolutely. Yeah, it's always there to serve story and character, which is what it should be. And it's funny because it's not often, a lot of the things that he does, I think, are quite subliminal. They're not necessarily, they don't necessarily bring your attention to it, all of the time. So,
or sometimes it does. I mean, certain imagery that just sort of tells you what the story is going to be all about.
Mm-hmm.
But before we move on to our picks, I just want to ask, did you ever see Fame, the TV series?
I have to say, no, I haven't.
Oh, okay. Well,
I just remember the theme tune, obviously.
Well, as a kid, growing up, my cousin was a massive fan. So whenever I used to stay around at my grandma's, you know, my grandmother's for the summer. And my cousin would always be there watching Fame. So I have to say, growing up as a kid, I hated it. Because I want to be watching cartoons, not Fame. But then going back, so remembering that and thinking, well, I'll go and watch the film, and how different the film was. That film was a hard PG.
It was
a lot. It was very different, especially the whole sort of sex element to it.
Right. Yeah.
Which wasn't in the TV series. I mean, well, I gather the TV series was very sanitized, and I haven't gone back and watched the TV series, but my memory of it was being very, you know.
Yeah.
They're going to do the theme tune, and then they're going to, you know, I think they made it a lot more family friendly.
Oh, I'm sure. Film. I'm sure, particularly if it was on at those sort of times anyway, and particularly back then. So, yeah. I mean, as I said, I never ever watched it, to be honest. I have a memory of the, might have listened to the beginning credits or whatever because of the song, and then switch it straight over to Wonder Woman or whatever.
But you've seen the film, though?
Yes, I have.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what did you think of the film?
Yeah, no, I thought it was, I said I've seen it. It was a long time back. It certainly wasn't anything I've visited recently. So, I'm delving back into my memory for that sort of thing. But yeah, it was, it was interesting.
Okay.
Girls in leotards, you know, what's not to like, right?
All right. Well, let's move on.
Let's move on, because I don't really remember much.
Okay.
Right.
Keith, what is your pick for Movie Heaven?
Right. My pick for Movie Heaven then is one that I kind of, thinking back, sort of stayed with me at the time. And it's in 1987, Angel Heart, which is kind of a, you know, film noir, horror, mystery, thriller, detective story. Essentially, this starred Mickey Rourke, back when he was sort of man of the moment in the 80s, you know, when he was like young in his 30s. And Robert De Niro. I went back. I remember seeing the film back in the VHS days again that we're always so fond of talking about. And, you know, this was at a point in time where I was quite interested. You know, I guess this must have been early 90s or whatever when it was out on video. I was becoming quite interested in you know, filmmaking and the craft and whatever. And, you know, Alan Parker's films, as I've already mentioned, were usually very interesting to watch. This particular one, it was interesting to go back and revisit it, actually, because I don't often do this, but it was one of those DVDs that I bought, you know, in probably 2003 or whatever. And I bought it, you know, it was a special edition. It came with a booklet and it had like, you know, lots of extras on it. So sort of thing I buy. But I think this is one that I may have, and it's very rare for me to do this, may have sort of put it in my collection and not actually watched for a while. Yeah. It was, I realized, I thought, you know, I haven't watched this in a long time. So it was good to dig that out and actually go through everything and, you know, watch the film and watch the commentary and watch all the documentaries and stuff and revisit it. And I think, you know, I think it absolutely holds up and works, you know, incredibly well.
Obviously, I just want to say that, I mean, I remember buying the exact same DVD and I'm kind of shocked that you didn't sort of, you know, you hadn't watched it, you know, since VHS.
DVD
was kind of like the first time I'd actually watched it properly.
Yeah.
I mean, I knew of it. I mean, it's, you saw it on the video shelves and it was always in the adverts on videos. So.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think so. I might have got that wrong, but my recollection, it was funny. I had that DVD and I know it's always been in the rack and I was like, you know, I don't know when I actually watched this. I couldn't recall the time I watched the DVD of it, if that makes sense. So I was like, oh well, let's go through it all again. And you know, I think one of the things about this film, obviously it was based on a novel, but the actual screenplay itself was by Alan Parker. So you know, he adapted this and you know, changed quite a few things from the novel to sort of make it more, you know, it's back to that thing we say about the difference between novels and movies, you know, just to make it a bit more cinematic. But, you know, one of the things which we were touching on earlier about, you know, how he handles the craft of the actual filmmaking itself is what's interesting with this film is, you know, essentially it's this, you know, guy's descent, guy's journey into hell. But it's done, even visually, it's very interesting because the early part of the film is very monochromatic. You know, he's everything from the, you know, the production design to the way it's shot and everything is fairly void of color. However, as things heat up and, you know, as he ends up, you know, going from New York, to New Orleans, the temperature and everything, you know, even the color of the film and the colors used gets warmer, almost as if he is, you know, getting closer to hell or whatever. And that's what I was meaning earlier when I was saying about some of the stuff that he chooses to do, he really uses the craft and the tools that he has, but he you know, sometimes done in quite a subtle way, just with, you know, the use of production design and color palettes and things of that nature. And that was something that
really I agree, but this film also includes the fan of death.
Yes.
Which is a wall fan that every time you see it, you know that somebody's going to die.
Going to die. No, absolutely. Yeah. Again, he puts that. But again, it's this nice mix because as we said, he was a big fan of the film noir cinema, you know, the sort of Raymond Chandler type stuff, and it's definitely got that kind of feeling to it as well. You know, he does this detective thing very well. In fact, that's something that always it always makes me think of, and I really like these kind of films and these kind of characters, is Polanski did that film with Johnny Depp called the Ninth Gate.
Oh, right, yes.
And it kind of, it has that sort of overall similar sort of detective. I know obviously in the Ninth Gate, Depp is like a book detective or something, but it very much has that feel and that style to it, and I just think it works really well for the material. So and I remember, it sort of took me back as to these were some of the things that sort of struck me about this film at the time, because it's kind of, you know, it really draws you in, because you don't really understand what's going on or where this is going. You know, it's very mysterious all the way through, and I think that it keeps that mystery and sort of holds you there with that quite nicely all the way through. And then obviously you get this reveal at the end of the film. But very, very interesting. As I said, Mickey Rourke. I think he's quite an interesting actor.
He was just, this was at the point where he was at the top of his game,
big star,
and also was De Niro as well. Because this was back in the days when he gave the damn. I mean, he still, there is one or two roles where lately that you can tell he gave the damn. But then when you see a poster on the side of the bus advertising Bad Grandpa with De Niro. Looking like he's bench pressing.
Yeah.
What was his name?
Zac Efron. Yeah, Zac Efron. Yeah.
I just like,
we've done
what
a couple
the hell?
Of films with him now.
You know,
yeah.
you just can't think this is the same guy who was in Taxi Driver. You know, this is the guy who's hailed as an acting genius. Yeah. And
well, I think he still is. It's interesting. His career seems to do sort of two sets of films now. He kind of does the films which are clearly a paycheck, and he ends up kind of almost being a caricature of himself. You know, he's got those films, but then, you know, like of late, the films he's done with David O. Russell, you know, I always think you're going to get quality from De Niro when he works with him. It's interesting.
Oh yeah, I mean, I'm saying there's certain roles where you can tell he gives a damn, and there's certain roles where you know he doesn't. He's there for the paycheck.
Mm.
I mean, he's just there to bankroll. What's that part of New York that he more or less owns now?
Oh, what, Tribeca?
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. No, absolutely. Well, why not? Yeah, that's encouraging new film talent and whatever, so it's all good.
But I
hear you, but yeah, you're right, this was very much when they were both very, very high in their game. I mean, it's interesting, Mickey Rourke kind of follows the sort of Brando-esque James Dean school of acting. I remember, Alan Parker commented that, he would tend to just sort of leave the camera on Mickey Rourke, because Mickey wasn't a particularly, we say about, you know, again, skills for cinema and whatever. He wasn't a particularly technical actor in the fact that, you know, he wouldn't do things the same every time in terms of his continuity and whatever, but he would never stop acting, so that, you know, you'd always get something interesting. And he said, you know, you could run quite long takes and he'd be different every time, which would give him, you know, something interesting to select in the editing process. But he said, but by the same merit, they could kind of also cause technical editing problems because of the lack of continuity that he'd have. And he said it was interesting when he and De Niro got together you know, to do those scenes. Because again, De Niro, you know, very much bringing a lot to this character. I mean, apparently the whole thing with the nails and the nails getting progressively longer in each scene that you see him in, that was all completely De Niro's idea, as was the cane that he selected, that his character has. And and apparently I read somewhere that he kind of, De Niro, and you can sort of see it when you watch it, based some of his performances and mannerisms on Martin Scorsese.
Oh. I didn't know that.
In the way he delivered some of his dialogue and just a few of his mannerisms and whatever, which was quite interesting.
Well, those scenes are always great. I mean, they are the sort of standout bits in the film. Mm. They only meet four times?
Three or four times, yeah. I mean,
because there's the initial time, and then there's the second time in the restaurant with the egg.
That's right. Oh, the scary stuff with the hard-boiled egg, yeah.
Yeah, saying that the egg in some religions is considered the symbol for the soul, and then he devours it. And then, there's the in the church when he's down in is it Louisiana?
That's right. Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
And then of course the final scene at the end. But there's one thing I didn't realize, and I only caught it this viewing, mm-hmm. was at the end, at the reveal of the death of Lisa Bonet's character, mm-hmm. you see the old woman that appears in the whole film, you know, you always see her, you know, always sort of in black with a veil over, and then it's De Niro,
yeah,
without a beard or anything. He just looks really, really
De Niro
weird.
In drag, yeah,
yeah. It's just, yeah. It's very weird. Weird.
Well, it is a weird film. I mean, it is a weird film. And you know, essentially the setup for this is, you know, it takes place in 1955, starts off in New York, and Mickey Rourke's a detective called Harry Angel, and he is hired by an associate of Robert De Niro's.
Come on, what is De Niro's name?
His name, well, it's not particularly subtle, is it? It's Louis Cipher or Lucifer.
Or as Harry Angel puts it, Louis Cyphier.
Cyphier, yes, exactly, Mr. Cyphier. but yeah, you know, he's hired to... to look into this disappearance.
Yes, of a musician called Johnny Favorite.
That's right, Johnny Favorite. This takes him. You know what would normally be a fairly routine case obviously turns into something that takes him much farther afield, and and gets him involved in this sort of world of voodoo. As well, which you know, as I said, it goes at a reasonable pace, film, but it is very engaging, and it's funny because it is the sort of film you can go back and watch again. I think we've talked about this with some other directors where there are clues throughout it, and if you go back and watch it a second time, you end up, it's a pretty different experience to because one of the things he does very well in this, I have to say, is we're always from the point of view of Rourke's character.
Yeah.
So in other words, he's the detective and we're on that journey with him, learning with him what's going on. And he does that very well. Yeah, no, absolutely.
It has to be because it's that's a good noir detective story. You have to learn the facts as our main protagonist is learning the facts.
Exactly. You don't see the murder at the beginning and then, you know, go back and we're ahead of the character. And this one we're completely with him, and it's all from his point of view, which is why a lot of the film seems very strange. Because you know there's a lot of strange stuff going on here, and he's trying to, you know, puzzle it together and figure it out, and And you know, good to see. I mean, it was really nice to see Charlotte Rampling in this film, a younger Charlotte Rampling, because obviously she's, you know, she is one of the greats, you know, of now. And it's in, you know, you forget that she's been doing this for years. So, a very good supporting cast. Obviously, this thing, I mean, it didn't mean a lot to me because I was never really into the Cosby Show, but Lisa Bonet or Boner or whatever.
Boner.
No, I'm just
Bone name.
But yeah, it was always very controversial, wasn't it? Because
well, it was. But I mean, okay. So knowing what we know now,
oh yeah, about Bill Cosby.
No. I'm not. I just want to say this because, again, from that DVD.
Yeah.
Lisa Bonet said that at the time she was offered this film, because she was still very young. I think she was like 17 or 18 when she did.
Yeah.
It.
Yeah.
And because of its graphic nature, she asked Bill Cosby if she should do it,
yeah,
or his advice. And knowing what we know now, it's weird that he seemed to be all right with it.
Yeah.
And then there's that whole, yeah, you know, that sort of just icky feeling now that, you know, that he was like, read the script and went, whoa.
Yeah. No, absolutely. I mean, it is, you know, her character, it's a very sexual role. It's one that, you know, in the US, it had that scene had to be cut for the US edition, you know, just because otherwise it would have put it from an R to what was then an X certificate. And yeah, it's really interesting. This just goes to show, you know, I always find this quite funny about the whole, you know, what British censors and what US censors have to change, because in the UK version, the bit that had to be cut was that there's that bit where he goes and there's a cockfight happening.
Ah, right. Yes.
And obviously that had to be edited for the UK certification, but obviously we had no problem whatsoever with the sexuality side of it, whereas in the States the cockfighting didn't bother them, you know, at all, yet they had a problem with the sex scene. So
yeah, well, I mean, it comes down to that we have two very different cinema systems, one being that an R, children could still go and see it with an adult.
That's right.
And they're thinking about the children. Mm. They don't want their kids seeing, you know, sex or dirty language. That would be bad for them. But violence.
violence is fine. Yeah, it is very odd, isn't it?
Yeah, it is very odd. So over here, you know, I guess the equivalent of an R would be a 15.
I suppose.
Am I right to say that? Or an 18. 15,
I would, you know, say an 18.
Well, I would have thought an X rating would have been, you know, would be the equivalent of 18. I mean, I'm not.
It's changed over the years, though. Yes, I know it has changed. So back when this, I mean, back in 87, I don't know. I don't know where the line was drawn on that. But you're absolutely right. I guess nowadays, yeah, an R would be like the equivalent of an 18. And because you have that, you have NC-17 as well,
oh,
don't you?
Right. Yes. Yeah, sorry.
So I think an R would be an 18 and, an NC-17 would be like a 15 or whatever. But of course, oh, okay, a lot of their stuff works like a PG, doesn't it? So yeah, it's odd.
Yeah. I mean, I just know myself from having a screening of my film over in the States, and seeing a parent just bring their child in, and then as soon as there was some swearing, soon left. I was like, "Do you not realize this is not for children?" It is very strange.
Yeah,
it's very very different. But I mean, of course, over here with animal cruelty to animals, or perceived cruelty to animals, because that was that scene in The Abyss that got trimmed.
Oh, with the rats, and being breathing underwater.
Like the US version of The Abyss, where that bit was a bit longer.
Yes, that's right.
At the end of the day, it didn't really add or subtract anything to it. I think it,
they used an alternative angle, didn't they, where they were on one of the characters instead of the lab mouse.
That worked fine.
Yeah,
I thought that was fine. But you just can't harm animals in this country.
Yeah. Well, the whole
people,
you know, the whole,
fine.
Yeah, I mean, you know, again, there is a lot of in this film. Actually, there's a lot of perceived cruelty to animals, because you have the bit with the horse that falls on him, and you have the bit with the dog that gets kicked by the horse. But I mean, obviously nothing is harmed whatsoever, and there's massively strict laws in the industry against that. But this film I think really works, and I was glad when I went back to watch it that I picked it as the Heaven choice, because I remember at the time it had an impact on me. And Alan Parker's got such a good collection of work, it's really hard to sort of narrow it down to pick one for movie Heaven. But in this case, I'm glad I did. And I anyone out there that hasn't seen this, I know we've sort of more or less told you what the outcome is, but
we haven't really spoiled it.
No, we haven't gone into
really
detail.
Talking about the twist in this, have we?
No, you're right. It's which actually is a little bit of a an Alan Parker thing as well. Quite a lot, not all, but quite a lot of his films involve a twist in them somewhere as well. So yeah.
I just want, there's one thing that always niggles me, and that is the opening sequence at the beginning with the credits playing over it. Mm-hmm. You see a body in a street, and you see Louis Saifier walking past it.
But standing for him. Yeah.
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 Well, knowing De Niro, it was him.
Yeah. Well, maybe. Yeah.
No. Knowing De Niro, it was definitely him.
Yeah.
I don't know him personally, but I've heard stories, and I think.
Oh, he's very. Yeah. He's very. Yeah,
anything. He wouldn't want to stand in. He would want to do it, because that's part of the whole performance.
Mm.
But I never know who that woman is. And I guess it's kind of hinted that they talk about this character, a fortune teller
that's right. Yeah.
And then I wasn't quite sure if that was Lisa Bonet's character's mother or something. Not in the opening scene, but that had gone missing. So I was never quite sure who that is.
Yeah, no, I know what you mean. And of course, you got the cat and everything. Yeah, maybe it was just to sort of set the scene of the violence of the area and the time or something. But I know what you mean. You never really know who that is. And
it might have been just
a little
soul he was collecting.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It might have just been backstory. Who knows?
But I have to say, there's only one thing I think that doesn't work, and that's the yellow eyes.
Yes. Yeah. Well, the thing is, that was, in fact, I think Alan Parker said, if memory serves, on the commentary, that he kind of regrets that now. I mean, obviously nowadays you just do that with a CGI thing, but at the time it had to be contact lenses.
It's not that. I think it's just the fact that
it didn't need it.
A touch. Yeah, exactly.
It didn't need it.
I mean, you've got De Niro there, and he's doing his best devil.
Yeah.
He's a lot more menacing than, say, Al Pacino's devil. Because Al Pacino's devil is just mischievous.
Yes. Yeah, kind of interesting, actually. They were on sort of, similar paths with this one. Yeah.
he's doing such a good performance that you just don't need those yellow eye contacts.
Yeah. I think Alan Parker feels that in retrospect, because I know when he actually recorded the commentary was probably around the late 90s, early noughties, when the DVD was coming out. And he does actually make that comment that it was a little on the nose, and in hindsight he probably wouldn't have chosen to do that, but that's the thing, when you that is quite interested actually you brought that up, because that is a thing when you know, when you're a director, you know, essentially your job is you're interpreting this script, and you know, it's, I always look at it, I heard it really well described once, is the directing process is something that starts with endless choices and options, and the further you get through the process, you get less and less and less and less and less choices until you end up with the finished film. And you know, that's so true. You know, at that time he obviously chose, that was a decision he made at the time that seemed right, and he chose to do it that way. But you know, when you go back and reflect, we always want to change things. And I agree with you though. I think it was completely unnecessary. We all got it.
Thankfully, it was very brief. I mean, with De Niro, it was one shot, and then with the kid, it's one shot as well.
It's kind of
But then, as I say, though, I do love the whole imagery of lifts, these old caged lifts. Descending.
Absolutely. I mean, especially
so the end credits, you see somebody get into a lift and go down, and then you hear De Niro's voice right at the end.
That's right.
Welcoming him.
It is a, you know, an interesting journey. You know, a very dark film, a very disturbing film. But you know, in terms of the craft of filmmaking, you know, the story is told really well, and it is beautifully shot and executed. As I said, even down to the little details, and you know, it captures that era very well. Instead of the sort of 50s being, well, I think he described it well, and I like this. Rather than a lot of films, like if they're set in 1955 or whatever, you know, production designers will go out and they will get things that were in 1955. But the reality is, particularly back then, when it was less of a throwaway society than we live in nowadays, is most of the stuff was still remnants from the 40s, that's what, you know, that's what they chose to do with this, was really go for 40s costumes and props and signage and things of that nature. And it worked really well, and it definitely then gave it even more of that sort of film noir you know, feel to the whole thing.
Indeed, and also it fits with the story because it's to do with an event that happened during the war.
Exactly.
Wartime. So
So there you go. So that you know, as I said, really good film, worth checking out, and solid performances and nice direction.
Indeed. Right. Well, moving on to my pick for movie heaven. Well, at the time, Alan Parker was on a bit of a roll.
He was.
The following year, he made my pick, Mississippi Burning.
Yes.
Now, I remember seeing this. I remember seeing again in the video shop and seeing the trailers, because I think it came out by Orion. It would have been probably, you know, distributed by Virgin. So Virgin always had that thing at the beginning of their videos that you'd get like a 10, 15 minutes, lots of commercials and stuff.
I used to love that. Yeah. Where you had, you know, you'd go and rent your film. Oh, I know we're real memory lane guys, aren't we? Probably younger people listening to you or whatever. But, you know, because obviously we didn't have YouTube then. So,
Netflix.
Exactly. You go and rent your film. You know, you'd bring it home, you'd stick it in the player, and part, you know, sometimes, you know, I watch many a film because I watch lots of, you know, straight to VHS sort of B movies and whatever. And often the trailers were actually more interesting than the film itself. Obviously not in this case, but, you know.
But I didn't catch this video. This film until it was on TV. So it was about mid-90s until I saw it. So I missed the sort of controversy about it, because when it came out, especially in the States, there was very much this sort of, kind of backlash against it, because it was like, how dare white people tell black people's story?
Absolutely. It was a controversial, again, it made people somewhat uncomfortable. Dealing with the whole civil rights.
Well, this is the thing. This film is a potboiler.
Mm.
It's a detective story about two FBI agents going down to Mississippi to find out what happened to three activists. Two are white and one are black. And there is that kind of, there's that racial tension in it. And when I was talking about earlier about how a single shot can set up the whole story, this film has it straight off the bat. It's a single shot of two water fountains.
That's right.
One that says whites only and the other one that says blacks.
Uh-huh.
And the difference between those two. I mean, the whites water fountain's very nice, porcelain. You know, it's actually got a button on it to let it stop and go. And the blacks one is kind of lower down and it's constantly running and it just looks terrible. And that just sums it up, how segregated, these two races were living in the same place.
Uh-huh.
And then, of course, the next shot is, of course, of a church being burnt down.
Yeah.
Fire. And that's what you have going throughout this whole film, is this sort of tension, this fire that's trying to bubble out and burst just because of, of how one group of people treat another.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think, it's interesting about Alan Parker with this sort of thing, because, the way he approached this, he tells the story, and I didn't feel that it was kind of leaning it from any particular way, from any point of view. It was just telling the story. It was the facts. You know what I mean?
Originally it was written by Chris Guillermo. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly, but Alan Parker actually rewrote it.
Right.
Because originally it was just about these two FBI agents coming there to investigate this case. And it didn't take on the social side of things, which after doing a whole lot of research, Alan Parker wanted to bring into it.
Mm-hmm.
And so because him and the writer had such a hard time working with each other, that Orion actually said to Alan Parker that he was to give them his draft, the script, and if they didn't like it, he would be off the film.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
So he took some risk with that then.
He did, yes. Which, fair enough, because the film is a classic.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
You have this relationship between these two FBI agents who have two different styles of detective work. You have the straight-laced, by-the-book character played by William Dafoe, and then you've got Gene Hackman's character, who used to be a sheriff who used to work in a Mississippi town. So he has an idea of how things work, how they really work.
Yeah, yeah.
And knowing that sometimes you have to bend the law to get things done. And for most of the film, you see William Dafoe's character trying to do things the right way.
Yeah.
And it always blows up in his face, or it never works out. And yet Gene Hackman's way is sort of the correct way of doing it.
Yeah, yeah.
Having to deal with it.
No, absolutely. I mean, William Dafoe does everything totally by the book. And Gene Hackman, he goes in there and, again, this was an amazing performance I think of Gene Hackman's. He is a wonderful actor, and there's just something about his honesty that always comes across in every scene. It's really well done. I mean, one important things to point out is this film is actually set in 1964. Yeah, so it's obviously a very different time. And,
yeah, and also based on the true story.
Yes, yes. No, and which again is another Alan Parker thing. A lot of his, the last one we talked about wasn't, but a lot of his films, a lot of his materials are somewhere based on true stories, aren't they? Quite a few of his films.
Some of them, yeah. Others not.
Yeah. Yeah, like the last one we just talked about. It clearly wasn't, but yeah.
No. But I like what he does with this film, that he has interviews with people living there.
Yes.
From this white perspective. So it really sort of, it kind of opens your eyes to how it was sort of that way.
Mm. No, exactly.
In the South.
Yeah, well, he said a lot of those he didn't, they weren't scripted as such. They were just interviewed, and he just sort of said, "Oh, can you talk a little bit about this?" And they'd he'd let them sort of ramble on, and they'd choose bits for the edit. But he didn't hold back. I mean, there was some real bigotry coming out there, wasn't there? So
I mean, there was also people who were kind of very even-handed about it, but you could sort of tell that there wasn't anything they could really do, that they could see what was going on, but that they felt there was nothing they could do about it, so they kind of was turning turning their back on it, or not seeing it. But I mean, it's a really good cast. I mean, you've got Brad Dourif playing the deputy.
Exactly. And
Brad Dourif's always great in this in films.
It's always value for money, isn't he? He's always entertainment value, is Brad.
Yeah. Well, the thing is, I'm watching Deadwood at the moment.
Oh, and, right.
He's just great as the doctor in there. But it is amazing that he can play a really unlikable character like the deputy, and yet he can play a really likable character like the doctor in Deadwood.
Uh-huh.
So, he's really good in it. I mean, in fact, he's always sort of smiling, and that kind of idea that he's gotten away with it, and he knows he's gotten away with it, and he's gonna laugh at it because there's nothing that these FBI agents can do. Also, you've got Michael Rooker.
Oh, that's right. Yes, yeah.
Playing,
an earlier role for him. Yeah.
Yeah, I think this was just after he did Henry, Portrait of a Serial Killer.
Yeah. Yeah, and he really does play a very nasty racist, doesn't he?
Oh, he does, yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, he's very... in fact, I love the... I do love the bar scene where Gene Hackman's character goes in to get a drink with the boys and, do a bit of investigating his way. And, Rooker's being absolutely foul and horrible in it, and he just ends up, grabbing his nuts.
Yeah.
And, puts him out just like that. It's brilliant.
Oh, that's it. So, and, the other actors, like Kevin Dunn, who plays a fellow agent.
Yeah. And, also, it's quite an early-ish role for... Frances McDormand in this. I mean, I know she was already married to one of the Coens and whatever by this point, but according to Alan Parker, he had to sort of fight a little bit to get her for this because they, the studio didn't initially want her for this role, and he kind of said, no, she really is the right actress for this, and he was absolutely right, because this is a great performance from her, isn't it? In this, the chemistry with her and Gene Hackman is incredible in this film.
It is. I mean, it's by the end of it, you do think that maybe there might be a future for him.
Mm. You kind of want there to be, don't you? But he doesn't go there, which I think is absolutely the right thing, you know, not to go there. But yes, you do kind of wish that for them, or at least I found I was watching it, because it felt like, you know, they're both such good actors and they really worked well together. I mean, there was definitely, you know, some chemistry between them, and you know, the scenes with them it's good. In terms of his directing choices, one scene I thought was very interesting, actually, and an interesting choice is when Jean goes to speak to her in the hair salon that she works in, but he keeps the camera and the point of view from outside the window, and obviously she's given, at this point, she's given his character some important, you know, information, but they show them looking through the window, but we don't hear they're saying.
Was that the point when she tells them where the bodies are, or is that the
point? No, I think that's earlier.
It's when she tells them about the guy they had just released, and who was going to be lynched.
That's right. Yeah. It's that part is earlier on in the story. But yeah, no, I just thought that was because for a minute, I don't know whether you felt this. I thought, oh my God, what's wrong? The soundtrack's is something cocked. Do you know what I mean?
I thought,
I like the way he's done that. I just thought that was a nice choice.
No, not at all. I've seen that happen in other films.
Oh, of course. I mean, it's been done. But it was a nice because what he did is he didn't do a whole scene like that. I thought that was what was quite in the thing that made it different was, we've seen lots of films where, you know, you go in and obviously information is held from the audience, you know, from a storytelling point of view, but this one he is actually in with them, and it's literally that just that bit that he comes outside and then goes back in, and I just thought, you know, I thought it worked quite nice. Anyway, it's just a little touch that sort of stuck with me, and I thought I like that.
Well, the thing about this film that I like, that I kind of respect, is the fact that for 90 minutes of this film, the redneck characters are getting away with it, and they're doing all kinds of damage. If it's not lynchings, it's, you know,
burnings.
I mean, the amount of churches that get burnt down in this film is just horrendous, and it's all from the idea of, because black people have been given the right to vote, but they were just trying to stop them realizing that they could do this, that why they were burning down churches was to stop them being used as places for voting.
Mm-hmm.
And so they were, you know, just still trying to keep them in their place and put them down. And so you have this going on. And then when finally, I mean, even when they find the bodies, there's still, the guys are still getting away with it. There's no proof that these were the guys who did it.
Uh-huh.
And it's not until Frances McDormand's character gets beaten up by her husband, it's when the tide turns. It's when William Dafoe's character lets Gene Hackman do it his way.
Yes, yeah.
He takes the kid gloves off, and that's when the tide turns. And then you suddenly, you know, they're getting their way. They're finally making some progress. And it's just so, it feels so gratifying, those scenes, when you're seeing these guys actually being taken down a peg.
Mm-hmm.
It was great to see the actor who plays Jigsaw as one of these guys.
Oh, that's right. Yes. Tobin Bell. He was one of the agents that...
That's right.
He doesn't have a particularly big part in it. But...
No, I think his only line was, do you have a 20? And then when the guy... change for a 20, when he puts his hand in the till, he pushes the till in and he says, if you still want to use that hand, you better come with us.
That's right, yeah. That's cool. And of course it's got Ali Emmy in as well, hasn't it, as the mayor.
Oh, the scene with him and the black FBI agent is really priceless, because thinking of it, I mean, just seeing Ali Emery the year before as gunnery sergeant in Full Metal Jacket, you know, this guy's hard as nails, and then suddenly seeing him being scared of this big black guy, Yeah. He's talking about a young man who had his balls cut off.
Yeah. Oh, it's that, in that scene, I mean, yeah, well, it's that thing. And I think any guy that hears something like that, it kind of does put your teeth on edge, doesn't it? Like, ooh, yeah. So, but yeah, no, that's a good scene. That's a very good scene.
It's a very good scene. Because, I mean, because he plays the mayor and he knew what was going on, but he had no part in it. And he is the one who spills the beans. He tells the FBI what happened. Point by point, and it's then up to them to try. I mean, it's great how they do it, because they get one of the, let's say, gang mem, you know, one of the members of the Ku Klux Klan who was involved in this to fear for his life, and then, you know, turn state's evidence against the other guys.
Yeah,
which they do brilliantly.
Oh, they do it really well. I mean, and you know, the end of this film is obviously very, you know, when you sort of see them get their comeuppance and whatever, it's very uplifting. But by the same merit, I didn't feel that the film was preachy in any way.
No.
Did you feel that?
Not at all.
Yeah.
Not
at all. It kind of dealt with the facts and, you know, told the story really well.
It showed that even though, you know, justice had been served, it hadn't been served completely, because the sheriff, who was, you know, totally involved in it, was... got off
acquitted,
scot-free.
Didn't he? Yeah, bastard. But yeah, see, it works. We're feeling it.
Well, that's it. Because I mean, you're watching the film, and it brings up those strong emotions as a viewer. You know, you can feel these guys' pain as they're trying to, you know, to solve this case, to actually bring these people to justice.
Yeah. No, absolutely.
Yeah.
No, it's a great film. I mean, this won an Academy Award for the cinematography, even though a lot of the actors and Parker as director and it as a movie was all nominated, but the only one it actually won was the cinematography award. But I mean, I obviously I'm sure it was up against some fabulous films, but
the acting, was the year that Rain Man won.
Oh, okay,
the awards, yeah. Yeah, Gene Hackman missed out to Best Actor to
Dustin.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Well, you know, interesting. But I mean, I thought both Willem and Gene were really good in this, as well as you know, as we've already mentioned, a lot of the supporting cast were great as well. I mean, this, you know, this film really has an impact, and it has some, you know, it has some absolute painful things to watch in it. You know, particularly the scene that I really didn't like, and well, I say didn't like, was I didn't like the scene, but what I mean is I didn't like what I was watching. Was you know, the bit where the guy gets strung up. That's horrible.
God, the farmer.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes. The one whose son helps them.
That's right.
He's not afraid.
No, the young boy with courage, yes, which I quite like that choice, actually.
The thing is, they're burning. He's a black man who owns his own farm.
Yeah.
And what they do is they start burning the shed with all the cattle in.
Yeah, he goes to obviously help the helpless cattle. You know, again, the cowardice of these people, you know. Yeah. You know, burning things, and you know the animals, and then you know, and running off and whatever. But when they do get him and string him up, that bit is horrible. And
it is. But it's harder still that the boy comes back and, you know, cuts
him down.
I still don't know if he died or not. I'm assuming he did die.
Yeah, I don't know because that is somewhat ambiguous because he was actually still alive when he cut him down, wasn't he? But whether or not he survived, I'm not sure on that. But you know, in terms of you know, when film is done well and done at its best, it works on the emotions. Yeah. Then that bit, that was horrific to watch. I thought that was horrible. Yeah. but did absolutely what it was supposed to do. So yeah.
Well, the other thing I quite liked about this film was the music by Trevor Jones.
Yes. Yeah, so he's worked. In fact, Trevor Jones did the music for Angel Heart as well. Yes.
Yes, he did. Yeah. Well, yes, yeah, so he, I think, for quite a while was a constant collaborator with Alan Parker.
Mm. Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, music in his films. I mean, that is something that Alan Parker, you know, feels is very important, as of course it is in film. Mm. But, you know, he always, again, that's always serving what's going on. So it's usually, it's usually something that's reflecting the themes or the times or, you know, what's going on in the film. And you're right, it is very effective in this.
Yeah. Though not as good as his score for Labyrinth.
Right, yeah. Oh, back to the Bowie thing. Yeah. Yes.
I thought I'd throw that in.
Yeah, there, you should have. Absolutely. Well, today's the day to throw that in, isn't it? Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, a great film, though. And another, I mean, it is a classic. And, once again, you know, wonderfully executed, I think, by Alan Parker. You know, it's hard to criticize this, really. I mean, I know it was controversial, more because of it, the subject matter, but obviously, it it's very acclaimed in terms of the craft, and rightly so, you know.
So, Keith, what is your pick for movie hell?
All right. Well, tonight is the night of my confessions. I have to say, I actually broke our rules. I broke the rules of movie heaven, movie hell.
What rules are those?
Well, I actually picked a film that I hadn't seen. All right.
Yes. Okay. Well, I think confession time. I picked a film I hadn't seen either.
All right. Fair enough. no, I picked for movie hell. In fact, his last film from 2003, The Life of David Gale. And the reason I picked it is I was looking down, you know, as I said, this amazing list of films that Alan Parker had done, and thinking, oh no, what the hell am I going to talk about for movie hell? You know, I it was really hard to pick. And I knew that this film had been both critically and commercially panned. And I sort of thought, it didn't do well at all. And I thought, well, okay, let's choose that and watch that and use that as movie hell. But the interesting thing that's happened through me not following the rules is I've picked it as movie hell, but I actually think it's fantastic.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, I don't.
Oh,
I think it is movie hell.
All right, interesting.
Oh, now the thing is, I didn't remember seeing this film.
I haven't.
I was thinking. So, yeah. I think what is Life of David Gale? It's just, I don't think I've seen it. And then when I sat down, I realized I had seen it. It was that unmemorable. And there is a lot of problems, and the twist does not work.
Right. Yeah.
And also, I think the ending is kind of ruined because ruined by the player.
Okay.
By the ending of the player. Because right. That was that kind of ending.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, you know, obviously it's good when we sort of disagree slightly on stuff, because that's what this is all about. And the reason I chose a film I hadn't seen, again, it's kind of what these podcasts are about, isn't it? Is discovering new stuff and revisiting stuff. But yeah, I picked it as movie hell, but I actually don't think it is, from my point of view anyway, movie hell. I really quite enjoyed it.
You agree with me that it's one of his weaker films.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, I mean, I know that there was a lot of, well for starters, okay, let's go back to the title, okay. As we know, you know, Alan Parker's been renowned, you know, speckled through his career of doing things based on you know, true events, real events and things of this nature. And the title kind of makes it sound like, oh, this is a biopic about, you know, some guy I've never heard of called David Gale, but, you know, I should look more into this. And of course it's not, it's a thriller. It's a work of fiction completely. I don't know whether that had anything to do with it for starters, whether it was one of those titles that kind of put people off or that they felt cheated by or whatever. I don't know, but
it's not a very good title.
No, okay.
It's a very, well, I don't know if it's misleading, but it just doesn't feel like a really good title. I mean, The Life of David Gale sounds like something that Disney would make.
Right, yes.
You know, it sounds like the feel-good film of the century.
Which, let's be honest, it certainly isn't.
No.
But you know, I don't know whether one of the things with this, and this was kind of, you know, a little bit what we were saying, I suppose, about Mississippi Burning as well, is, you know, the film works as a, and this is probably why I enjoyed it, you know, it's essentially a thriller, this is, okay. However, it's dealing obviously with a very serious and controversial topic again. In this case, it deals with death row and you know, the death penalty in the state of Texas. But it doesn't really, it is kind of about that, but it doesn't really have a massively a sort of big slant. It's not preachy, is it? Again, we're going back to that. It's not preachy about it. It's kind of...
I think the problem with the film is that it takes a very serious subject and then it throws in a ridiculous twist.
A
hugely ridiculous twist with an ending of somebody trying to stop the execution at the end.
Yeah.
Now, if you know this podcast, you know we're into spoilers.
Oh, spoilers. Yeah. I was almost wondering, actually, for anyone who does want
to
see it.
Well, I think we have to discuss it because this is the problem. So you have a character who's been put into jail for the murder of a friend. He is a man who's campaigning against capital punishment and he's thrown into jail, you know, for murder.
Yeah.
And he is executed. Now, the murder.
And, well, the irony is, yeah, he is obviously, you know, all for the abolishment of capital punishment, but ends up being the guy on death row. So yeah.
Well, but the thing is, it's all orchestrated. See, you get two twists. So the first twist is that it's been orchestrated by a fellow abolitionist, or, you know, activist.
Yeah.
And she's murdered herself for the cause with the help of her boyfriend, stroke friend, or whatever he is. That I kind of believe that, you know, that they did this to...
For the cause.
For the cause. Because the whole point is being that early on, so what you have is you have Kate Winslet interviewing... Kevin Spacey in prison three times and he tells the story of what happened, and then, you know, she gets this videotape where she sees the murder or the you know, but my point being is that early on you see that he has an interview with the governor, and the governor says to him, can you name one innocent person that we've put on death row?
Yes.
And then straight away, I knew that was what the twist was going to be.
Right.
That he didn't do it. He's an innocent person. He's been a martyr for the cause. And the way they play it is as if the other people in the group orchestrated it so that he would be the martyr, but he didn't have any control of it. But then we get the final twist when we find out that he actually was in on it, that he went willingly, maybe he was the mastermind of it. And then you think about everything that's just happened, what he spoke about, it makes no fucking sense. you know, the whole thing with the rape, because he's accused of rape.
Mm-hmm.
Was that orchestrated by him? Or was that just something he used? And it just like, it just makes no sense. See, the thing about a twist is that it's supposed to make you look at the story in a different light. And you kind of go, oh, bloody hell. So when you go back and watch it again, you know, knowing the twist, it's a completely different story. And if you do it right, it works really well. I mean, you know, The Sixth Sense was really
that's classic.
Good for that.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
It's classic. It's great writing. And it's directed so well. And it's just unfortunate that M. Night Shyamalan decided to make that film over and over and over again.
Yeah, no, that's a whole nother podcast, but absolutely, we can. I mean, well, I'll be honest. I don't know. I didn't totally see it coming. I'll be honest, and I'm usually quite good at these things, but I don't know. I was kind of because obviously, you know, one of the reasons I wanted to watch this is I thought, well, why didn't this film do well? Why has it received such negative reviews? And you know why? Because you've got Kevin Spacey, Kate Winslet, and Laura Linney as the three sort of main characters, all of which are fabulous actors, you know, in their right. So, I kind of went with it, and obviously you're totally with the Kate Winslet character, because she plays the journalist that is sent, you know, to actually give this interview or do this interview with David Gale, who's the Kevin Spacey character. And you know, obviously the rest of it is done in sort of three. I quite like the way they went into the flashbacks, you know, they did that.
I thought that was really bad. The spinning camera and the flash frames of writing, I thought that was awful.
Okay.
I thought that was really bad. I thought it just did not work very well at all.
Oh, interesting. Okay, because I quite liked, again, as we've sort of talked about with Alan Parker, is you know, some of the, you know, the style choices, I actually thought, you know, was all handled quite well. And what one of the things I liked about this as well is, you know, it's nepotism rules again here, but he obviously worked with his two sons on the soundtrack for this. And the song in it, something about it reminded me of that Shriekback song from Manhunter. I don't know whether you know the one I mean, but I quite liked all of that stuff.
Which song on Manhunter, or which scene from Manhunter did the music
play? It was the one where when you're around Dollar Hides with him and the
in the Garden of Eden or whatever it's called.
Yeah, I try to think.
Dolce Vita. It's the one where he's watching
the movies with her. Yeah, and she's.
Oh, okay. That's not the Strong as I Am track then. Where he sees.
I shouldn't have gone here, should I? Because I can't remember. I can't remember. But anyway, the song kind of reminded me of that in its style, and I enjoyed it. I just thought it was. You know, I like the performances here. You know, Spacey had a tough job in this one, in so much as, you know, his character, you know, has a drinking problem as well. And so obviously he spends quite a few of the flashback scenes actually drunk. And, you know, that's a very hard thing to play convincingly. And I'm not sure he was successful all the time in that. Actually, there were bits where I was like, oh, you know, in places performance seemed a little forced, but yeah, I don't know, it was kind of, maybe, you know, I mean, again, this is interesting, isn't it, when you watch stuff, it's quite possible, because it had been so, because, well, certainly because I'd picked it for movie hell, yeah. I was perhaps trying to find stuff wrong with it, which I actually ended up thinking weren't that wrong with it, if that makes sense. Because I enjoyed the ride of this film. I enjoyed the story, and I thought it was, you know, well executed. And I think it got, you know, I think a lot of people got put off seeing this, and I don't think it's necessarily as awful as what it's made out to be. But well, obviously you disagree with that, which is fair enough.
I disagree. And I think one of the other problems is the Kate Winslet character in it, that the fact that she believes him hook, line, and sinker. She's never once says to him, you know, what about this or what about that, or doesn't believe him or has any doubt. And she's sort of straight away after the first meeting, she's there ready to prove his innocence, you know, and she's kind of like is a sucker for this, because again, it's one of these plans that without Kate Winslet's reporter character, it wouldn't work.
Yeah, no, absolutely. You're right. She was obviously selected, wasn't she, by him for the interview. So, you know, she has like 3 days or 4 days to conduct this interview before
it's chaired. It's three days, isn't it? Yeah. But it goes, the story takes place over 4 days because she has to do the run to try and stop the execution. And this is what I'm saying. This is why the player has ruined that, because it does feel like I could just imagine some executives going somewhere, well, this is a really bit of a down ending, so we're gonna make it more upbeat. We're just gonna have Bruce Willis go in there and save Kevin Spacey.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, and I mean, there's that whole thing because her car breaks down.
Well, they start,
and she's got to run for it, and it's just like that's straight out of the player.
Yeah, they
really
they,
is. They, and he goes, you know, traffic was rough. It's serious. I was
I'm loving the fact you've linked it to Altman now with the player. Yeah, brilliant. No, I mean, yeah, they start with the running start, don't they? And they've got her, like, you know, and then the rest of the
film. I think the other problem you have as well is that up to this point, Kevin Spacey has played similar characters to this, you know, untrustworthy.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, by this point, he'd played, spoiler, Kaiser Sose.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
And he played...
Great movie. But yeah, okay.
You know, and also he'd been the main guy in Seven.
Yes.
And so these are guys who, you know, are untrustworthy, or that you get to know and then find out that everything you knew about the guy was wrong. But just...
So you think he came with baggage, is what you're saying with this, yeah?
Well, out of those three roles, this is not even par of those two at all, because it's just, you know, it's kind of like there's really nothing. I mean, okay, you know, there's a lot going on with the character, but at the end, you just go, bleh. When the final twist, when you sort of see him come on camera and, you know, sees the dead body of Laura Linney on the floor, you know, Laura Linney isn't actually dead, but her character is. And you just go, bleh. And you just go, well, that was a waste of time then, wasn't it? You know,
you wanted your 90 minutes back, did you? Or your two hours or whatever it was.
That's 2 hours, mate. Take the twist from Angel Heart, and then you take the twist from this, and I mean, the twist in Angel Heart is devastating.
Mm-hmm.
The twist in this is, it's so, it just doesn't work with a film that's dealing with important subject matter.
Yeah.
If anything, it kind of demeans it a bit.
That's the thing that I think that's one of the reasons that you know, certainly critically, you know, it got panned is that it didn't deal with the issue particularly. It just used the issue as a backdrop for this story, for this thriller.
Yeah.
I mean, initially, and he was a producer. Initially, Nicholas Cage was involved with this. This was going to be a Nicolas Cage project, and Alan,
that would have been interesting.
But you know, Alan Parker was kind of intrigued and interested in it. And
I saw the sort of promo video for this, and he was saying that that whole year he'd received scripts, and there was nothing there he liked, and then he got the script to this. And this was by a first-time screenwriter called Charles Randolph.
That's it.
And he loved it, and he wanted to do it.
Yeah, yeah.
But the thing was, I get the feeling that he just then went, "Yay, let's go and do it," and just did it as is. Where, like with Mississippi Burning, he went, he did his research, and went, "Oh wait, there's a bigger story here."
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. No, I mean, I'm not that's, suggesting that's it's what's up missing there with that. I'm not suggesting.
No, but I mean,
but I enjoyed it for what it was.
Yeah, I mean,
I don't think it deserved the panning it's got, but
I do. I think it does. I mean, the thing is that it if it had just been a thriller about a guy who was, you know, in there, and he was really innocent, would be fine. But then they throw in the whole thing of him being an activist against it, but then don't actually bring the Activision or anything really into it. I mean, it's very fleeting what those guys do, and you never see, you know, there's no moments like inmates, people on death row being interviewed.
Yeah.
Or, you know, I'm not talking real people on death row, but characters playing people on death row. There's none of that. You know, and it just, I guess they didn't go that way because they felt that because this is such a, it's a thriller and it's tight and all this stuff, that it needed to concentrate on that. But then why have the whole, you know, anti, apart from making the twist work, and which it's just it's a wasted opportunity.
Yeah. Well, interestingly, I mean, this is back to where we started at the beginning. This was the last film he made, and he hasn't made one since. So, you know, who knows whether that's to do with the fact that this film was a failure, and he hasn't been able to, you know, get funding to get new projects made, or, you know, maybe beyond this he's lost interest. I mean, I don't know.
I would say it's the latter, because I don't think that if Alan Parker wanted to make a film, and I don't think he'd have a problem getting funding. I think he'd have less of a problem than we would.
Yeah, I mean,
his last film might have not done well at the box office, but then when you've got films under your belts that people consider to be classics.
Yeah. When he did his interview at BAFTA, he did talk, you know, again, he's quite outspoken, and he did talk about how difficult it is to get funding for the projects. But when I went to see it, actually, it wasn't his receiving the fellowship or anything. It was the same year as that, but it was it was actually they had a special screening, which is a totally different film of his, but one that I really like, of The Commitments. So they had a special screening of that with a Q&A with him afterwards. So they talked about his career, but they didn't sort of linger too much on things like this, for example, because it was more about The Commitments and you know, obviously that journey and that film, which is a very, you know, a very different film of his. And again, one that I remember sort of, you know, back in the day when it was on, I a real fan of that film, and visiting it a couple of years later, you know, again, that could have been a contender for movie heaven. Definitely.
Oh God. Yeah. I mean, yeah, I really considered that film, but Mississippi Burning was just a bit over.
I agree.
Saying that though, Wilson Library, every St. Patrick's Day, they had a cinema there. They would play The Commitments.
Mm-hmm.
So, I never did it, but I always remember going past it and seeing the sign-ups that The Commitments were on. And I know they toured as a band for a while, didn't they?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, the music in that was fantastic, and that film was really well done. But But yeah, so you know, for what it was, I didn't totally hate this film at all. I mean, I know often my movie hells are sort of, you know, movies that I think are just okay or whatever. But but no, I actually enjoyed this. Obviously, as I said, I went in. Well, you know, I often think, would my experience of it have been different if I'd gone fresh to the cinema to see it, to see a new Alan Parker film, not knowing any of the, the reviews and the sort of about it. I wonder whether, you know, I'd feel differently. But watching it with this in mind, watching it with the minute it came on in my head is, oh, well, this is my movie hell, so I need to pick this to bits sort of thing. It actually surprised me. It was actually not quite as, you know, not half as bad as I was expecting.
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, you went in with low expectations. I went in with low expectations.
But you still hated it.
It met my expectations.
Yeah. Right. One other thing that just about Alan Parker in general. I know we still got another film to talk about, but something guy, you know, he repeats quite often in his commentaries and interviews, which I find quite interesting about filmmaking and about him as a filmmaker, is he's not so much into, you know, building sets and filming things at a studio. He said, even though obviously it comes with massive problems to actually film on location and you know, film in real locations and things of that nature, he said he likes that because he feels that you know it brings authenticity and it brings something you quite can't quite put your finger on, but it brings something to a project. So quite often you know, he and his crew will go to the actual locations, like, you know, Louisiana or wherever to film, you know, obviously for the exteriors. They're not trying to make somewhere in, you know, part of the US look like it. They actually go to that place. And likewise, when they film an interior, again, it's, you know, it can be problematic filming, as we all know, but often they'll use an actual existing building or location and redress it for the production design. Will go in and completely redress it for the purposes of the story's filming. And I thought, you know, that was quite interesting to hear, you know, in terms of his approach, that he likes to do things that way, because you know he feels that it brings that nth degree to something. So yeah, so and the reason I bring that up is a lot of the prison scenes in this were actually, they were recreated, but they were filmed in the actual place, which I thought was quite interesting. So it wasn't on actual death row, but it was filmed at that prison. So interesting.
Well, moving on.
Moving on.
My pick for movie hell is The Road to Wellville.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I remember seeing the trailer for this in the cinema, and my reaction was, what the fuck? it very weird.
A journey into the bizarre, yes.
Well, the trailer makes it look really weird, but when you watch the film, not so much. I think the thing was that the trailer makes it look really zany, and it's not that zany. I mean, they're going for the zany element. The first thing that starts the film off is a lot of people laughing.
Yes, yeah.
But not laughing in a natural way. They're going, ha, 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 ha.
Yeah.
And it's in time to music. And in the soundtrack, they use a kazoo a lot.
Yes.
And if you use a kazoo in the soundtrack, that means you're zany.
Quirky, yeah.
It means you're wacky. So there's a lot of kazoo going on in this film.
Right, right.
A lot of kazoo action. But, I mean,
At
the end of the day, it's about a cult.
Yes, yeah.
It's this weird amalgamation of, it's a sex fast where you have Matthew Broderick and Bridget Fonda visiting this sanitarium, the Battle Creek Sanitarium, that's run by Dr. Kellogg's, him of the cornflakes fame.
Yes, indeed.
Yes. Who is an absolute health freak.
Yeah.
To the nth degree.
Yeah.
I mean, total nutcase for the fact that he talks, you know, he examines people's stools or shit. I mean, seriously. I mean, Anthony Hopkins is having a really good time in this.
Well, yeah. I mean,
he's got these teeth that make him look a bit like a rat.
Yeah, I remember because again, this was a film I went to actually see this in the cinema in '94. And I went to see it because it was an Alan Parker film. So there you go. The fact that it was an Alan Parker film made me want to go and see it. I'll be honest, I did tried everywhere. I wasn't able to actually get a copy of this to rewatch for the purposes of this podcast. So I am going back some years now when I last saw it, sadly. But I remember one of the things that sort of struck me about it is let's be honest, Anthony Hopkins, wonderful actor that he is, he's not the most chameleon-like of actors. He's always pretty much Anthony Hopkins, yeah? Whereas in this, it did seem that, by wearing the odd teeth and whatever, he was able to sort of transform his performance quite a bit to what we're used to from Hopkins. Is that fair to say on revisiting it?
Yeah. I mean, I have to say, I'm akin to your confession. I had not watched this.
Oh, okay. You hadn't.
Right. I picked it solely off my memory of this trailer.
Okay.
The trailer was so off-putting that I just did not want to watch this film. So that's why I picked it. So it's my first time watching it.
Interesting. Okay.
It's not as bad as the trailer is. It's just very, it's somebody trying to do a comedy and just missing the mark.
Yeah.
It's not very funny. There were moments where I laughed.
Mm-hmm.
The one thing I really laughed at was at the end. Cause you know, you got Dr. Kellogg's as a health freak and you know I'm this age and you see him sort of dive into the water and in mid dive he has a heart attack.
Oh.
And that floored me.
Right.
because that only floored me because throughout this whole film he's been such a fanatic about cleanliness.
Yeah.
To the point of, having no sex, having enemas five times a day,
right,
being a vegetarian,
and is that how he died? I mean, is that true?
Yeah,
that is true.
I don't know.
Okay,
I don't know, but that's how he dies in the film.
Right.
I didn't go and
you didn't research John Harvey Kellogg. No. Okay.
No.
All right.
No.
No. Fair enough.
But the thing watching. Matthew Broderick's character is sort of brought there. He doesn't want to, he wants to leave. He doesn't like it there. And he's literally, dragged off to his room by these two orderlies, mm-hmm. big orderlies. And then when he's sitting for lunch with everybody, one of them starts singing the song and everybody starts singing it on cue.
Right.
As soon as they hear it, they're singing it. And they're like, these people are like, brainwashed, and the things that they believe is good for them, like they have these they're like electric baths.
Mm-hmm. Oh so yes, having, I remember this. Yes,
yeah, having baths and they have electricity going into it. And Matthew Broderick, his character is like the voice of reason. He's like, isn't this bad for you? It's water and electricity. And the John Neville character is like, oh no, this is really invigorating. And of course, they have a character who's called Mr. Unpronounceable. gets electrocuted.
Right.
And well, this is where the farce comes in, because they have several people who die accidentally. You have, like, I don't know, he's the assistant or the accountant, has a heart attack. And Dr. Kellogg is like, this is really bad publicity for my sanitarium. You're having a heart attack. You died outside my sanitarium. You also have... so he dies. You have Mr. Unpronounceable have a heart attack. And then also you have Laura Flynn Boyle's character die as well.
Right.
Because she don't eat. In the film, she's very grey.
Right.
And, it's just this weird thing where he's working on people's neuroses and about health and fitness and just sort of brainwashing them in his way of doing things, which is, totally wrong. But in the film, they show the sanitarium as a clean place, very clean. Mm-hmm. The normal world, where people eat meat and drink alcohol and stuff, dirty as in muddy, dirty, people covered in dirt, it's a mess. Mm-hmm. It's the dishes you wouldn't want to eat off. And they're just... it's really sort of trying to, elaborate, really sort of show the two different worlds. I don't know if it's Alan Parker saying that he kind of likes the world of the sanitarium because it's very clean, it's very pristine, and yet the normal world with normal people, it's dirty, it's grungy.
So this is basically it's a lot more, like we were saying about, he does a lot of things that are quite subtle and subliminal, but this is a lot more heavy-handed in its approach.
It's very heavy-handed. I think because it's been like a wacky comedy that he's gone down that route, because thankfully not all of the story takes place at the sanitarium. You also have John Cusack's character.
That's right.
Who is a entrepreneur.
Yes.
Who's come down to Battle Creek to start a rival cornflake company to Kellogg's with a Mr. Bender.
Yes.
And who turns out to be a swindler and has used all the money,
And he creates cola, is that right? Is that?
Oh, at the end, yes.
Yeah,
Coca-Cola.
Yeah, I seem to remember that, but there's bits and pieces. I mean, I remember thinking it was really weird, and it wasn't what I expected from Alan Parker. But I mean, I this was him, I guess, trying to deal with a different genre and trying to deal with a comedy or a farce or however you want to call it, a bizarre piece of work. Yeah. I sort of remember, I didn't kind of have a desire to watch it again, particularly, hence, why I hadn't seen it up to this point. I did try and see it. It's not that easy to get hold of. It's not on Netflix. It's not on Sky. It's not easily available on DVD anywhere without paying quite a bit of money. And after getting burnt with Space Truckers, I thought, no, I don't really want to do that again. It's funny. It's one when people mention Alan Parker, it's not one of the, obviously things like The Wall and Birdie and The Commitments, in the films we've reviewed tonight, sort of spring to mind, Midnight Express, etc. But this really doesn't, does it? It's not one you sort of think about and that's an Alan Parker film.
I have to say I'm glad they had to sort of the other storyline going, because that was a bit more interesting. And there was a third storyline which I thought was actually far more interesting than anything that was going on in either one of the other ones, and that was the storyline of Dr. Kellogg's and his son George.
Okay.
Especially when George was a little boy.
Oh, is this George played by him of Wayne's World fame?
Dana Carvey.
Yes, yeah.
But it's not the Dana Carvey, not him, not the George played by him, but the George played back in flashbacks by the young George.
Right.
The story goes is that Dr. Kellogg cannot create children.
Right.
And so he adopted a whole load of them, including George. and out the lot of them, George is the rebel.
Mm-hmm.
And he never does what he's told. And when every time he gets disciplined, he turns it back on them. He goes so far that they have to make him stop. I mean, the first incident is when he's told to come in and put his coat on the hook. And so he has to do that until 4 o'clock.
Uh-huh.
And he has like a nanny who's looking after him. And when he comes back, he finds that the kid's still doing it.
Right.
And it's like, it's time to stop. And the nanny says he won't stop. And he does. He just carries on and he keeps on doing it all through the night. And to the point where he annoys everybody else. And, you know, Dr. Kellogg has to stop him from doing it. And he's just... it's just this wonderful relationship. I mean, it works out at the end with the older George, but I'm watching these scenes. I'm thinking, wow, these scenes are far more interesting than the rest of the stupid film. Mm.
It's annoying when that happens.
They work really well.
It's annoying when a subplot is more interesting than the main story. Yeah. And
see, I would like to have seen a film just about that relationship.
Mm.
That storyline could have been, I would have loved to have seen that, because the young actor who's playing the kid was just great. He had a really unique look to him as well, especially with the little curled up hair sticking up. And yeah, it was just a shame.
The Road from Wellville. There you go. is this? I mean, is it the road to woeful?
Just a bit. Yeah. Yeah, like you, it's a film I don't think I'd ever go back and watch again.
Right.
But saying that, I was very happy to see an actress in it that she hasn't done many parts, but I'll always like it when she turns up, and that's Tracy Lind.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember her from Fright Night Part 2.
Oh, right. Okay, yes.
She played the girlfriend in it.
Right.
And I always thought she was very good, but she only did a few roles, and then she sort of disappeared. I think she got married and had kids and decided.
God, you mean she chose a life instead of the career?
What the hell is she doing? That's the case. I believe that's the case. I don't know.
Okay.
Or maybe she decided to have a different career or something. But I always like it when I see her appear in a film, so I was very happy to see her in this.
Oh yes. Yeah, I'm just looking her up now, actually. Now you mentioned that. What was the last thing she did then? Oh yeah, she hasn't worked since the late 90s. So yeah, shortly after that film, then she didn't work anymore.
Yeah. Mm. But I have to say, all the actors in it are in really good shape. And I think because they knew that they were going to be in the buff a lot. So Matthew Broderick was probably in the best shape he'd ever been in.
Okay.
Because the amount of time he's got his shirt off in it, it's
not ridiculous. Not the Stepford Wives shape then. Yeah.
No.
Ah. Yes. Okay. Well, yeah, interesting. Yeah. As I said, it's unfortunate that I wasn't able to sort of revisit this one to offer a bit more than just a memory about it. but I do remember it's certainly not, in my opinion anyway, one of his standout movies.
Well, it stands out, but just for all the wrong reasons.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's something that was a very different performance from Anthony Hopkins. But again, I can't really remember whether I thought that was different good or different bad.
Well, he was good on screen, I'd say that. I mean, he's always very watchable.
Yeah.
And it was nice to sort of see him look very different from his usual look, as you say, because in the films he's always Anthony Hopkins.
Yeah, yeah. Yes. Funny what a prosthetic will do, isn't it? Yeah.
So, do you have any last words about Alan
Parker? Only that this is kind of, it's interesting because, you know, there are so many directors out there and, you know, we've all got our favourites and whatever, but... yeah, it's just kind of made me want to go back and watch more Alan Parker, really, which is good. It's made me want to, you know, revisit some of the, because there are some of his films that, you know, I've only probably seen the once. There may even be a couple in there that I've not seen still. And it does make me sort of think, yeah, this is, you know, he is he is a director. I definitely want to check out the website you mentioned.
Oh, please do. It's a great website. And
especially if he's got essays and stuff on there. I love all that stuff.
Yeah.
You know,
alanparker.com.
Yeah, alanparker.com.
He's got his like on-set diaries and stuff on there.
So. Yeah, I mean, I know. As I said, I was doing the research. There was a hell of a lot more that I intended to talk about and mention with him, as is always the case with these things. But I'm slightly the worse for wear today. So I'm finding that I'm having to search for things and. I don't feel like I'm being particularly eloquent here today. he's definitely one. If people haven't seen his work, then he is definitely well worth checking out, because you know he knew his craft and he told some excellent stories. But you know it was mainly through the 80s and 90s, or the late 70s, 80s and 90s, and like you said, since the turn of the century, he's kind of disappeared off the boil a little bit, which is a shame.
Yeah, but he's still a hell of a legacy to leave behind.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Right, well, we're going to sign off in our usual manner. So, Keith, how can we find your work?
Simply go to YouTube and put in British Eyles, E-Y-L-E-S. See, I told you I've lost it today. British Eyles, E-Y-L-E-S, and you will find short films that have been written and directed by me.
And you can find my work at independentrunnings.com. Please subscribe to the show on iTunes, on Mixcloud, on YouTube, and on Stitcher. Please leave us a review and rating. And check out our next podcast coming next week.
Really appreciate the support from everyone. So please leave us a review.
Exactly.